Morning.
Morning.
Welcome to our worship here on this 2nd of July and Sunday in Pentecost. As we share this time, you might be confused because Aline, thank you Aline, has jumped in to play the organ because Brian is stuck in traffic, and we hope we'll be here midway through our worship service. That's just the nature of things in Pentecost season sometime. The Spirit moves in all kinds of ways. Mark is here today, and welcome Mark your role. And I'm here today. I wasn't last week, and thank God because you called a new settled pastor. Or at least some of you did because you're members of the church here. But meanwhile, we're a mixed congregation today because we want to say welcome to all of you from Burlington Presbyterian Church. All this adds up to God being worshiped by the power of the Holy Spirit that draws us here and brings us in all kinds of surprising roles sometimes. And if I sound confused sometime today, it's because I'm deciding which clock to look at. The new clock is running 10 minutes behind the old clock. Go figure. I think, though, it has something to do with the fact that the clock in the back in that location always keeps chronos time, minute-to-minute time, but this one here is engaged in kairos time, which is meaningful time. And that means whether the worship starts early or late, once it starts, we're in meaningful time. So now if I stop welcoming you and keep quiet, we can have announcements and then get into really meaningful time.
Good morning. Welcome to this joint worship service with the United Church of Christ Congregational and the Presbyterian Church in Burlington. God calls us to love unconditionally, seeking to be an inclusive and respectful community for persons of every color, age, sexual orientation, gender, ability, and economic means. All are welcome to join this faith journey. You are also invited to join together after worship for coffee and conversation in Sewell Hall. Just follow the crowd through the doorway to my right, your left, and all are welcome. On behalf of the Presbyterian congregation, I'd like to thank our friends at the UCC for your hospitality this morning, with special thanks to Joan Zink, who donated the lovely flowers here up in the chancel to welcome us. Along those lines of thanksgiving, we also thank the youth here at the UCC and their leader, Deb Raymond, who've been coming over to help us set up our monthly free community dinners at the Presbyterian Church. Last Wednesday, they also provided homemade lasagnas and salad that fed somewhere between 30 and 40 guests. I lost count at some point. Their help is much appreciated. Everyone in Burlington area, including you, are invited to join us for these free dinners the last Wednesday of every month. No reservations are needed. Today is Communion Sunday. For those joining on Zoom, please be sure you have your bread and drink handy for worship. If you're here in person, please let the head usher know if you haven't received the little packet with the communion element as you entered the sanctuary. Note to those in the Presbyterian congregation joining us online, there is a link to this morning's bulletin on the Presbyterian Church website in a salmon pink-colored box near the top of our homepage. Those attending here in person, please remember to fill out the friendship slip attached to the bulletin and place it in the basket during the offering. If you've changed your email address, phone number, switched from landline to cell, this is a good way to keep things up to date for the offering. Finally, if you're joining us on Zoom, please send your prayer requests to the Zoom host in the chat, and they'll give them to Pastor Ed to lift up during the prayer time. Let us now center ourselves for worship.
In our opening call to worship. Let us worship our God with gladness.
Creation.
Let us worship our God with thanksgiving.
Praise God for the blessing of human freedom.
Let us humble ourselves before Jesus' way, life, and truth.
Let us be moved by the Holy Spirit regarding our stewardship and God's creation.
Let us join together now in singing the first two verses of Guide Me, O My Great Redeemer, number 18 in our Black Hymnals.
As we pray our opening prayer. Holy God of miraculous power and amazing grace, we give you thanks for the life and liberties that are ours in this land. Guide us the gifts we need for using our freedoms wisely, compassionately, and responsibly. Help us to witness faithfully to bring a critical and constructive love to our nation and all the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite you to be seated. So as we gather this time, In our Children of God time, I'm looking around, and we have two younger children in our midst, and nice to see you this morning. And I have a question for you two. Because if I ask this question,
and some of the older children of God around, I might get a different answer. How do you feel about your birthday? Good. Do you have your birthday? How many of you like having birthdays? Well, good. That's an act of faith. Some of us still like having our birthdays. They aren't quite the same as they used to be, though, are they? And I asked the question on today because we have a special holiday coming up in our United States, right? The 4th of July is our birthday. And I guess the question is, how old are we as a nation? Anybody have the number? 247? Anybody want to do the math? 2023 minus 1776. I have 347 here. Anybody want to go higher? Well, and I guess, I think it's 247, but the question I have, does that make us an older or younger nation? And are we going to make it to 347? And I guess that's a serious question. Maybe we'll save that for our sermon time for all us children of God, especially us who are older. But I think one of the things that's appropriate to ask, I bet you love your birthday because you received some gifts, right? How many like receiving birthday gifts? Yeah, I saw some of you out there who said, well, maybe I like my birthday or not, maybe not so much, but still like receiving birthday gifts, yeah. I think one of the questions for us to ask as citizens of the United States is, what kind of gift, what kind of birthday gift can we give to our nation this year? Peace. Yeah. And we'll be focusing on that gift, I hope, reflecting on it, as well as maybe some other gifts we can give the citizens during our sermon time. Meanwhile, let's need to take a moment to remember the concerns we bring here today for our nation, for ourselves, for those we know, for those we don't know, for our churches, what have you. And so I wonder, as you look at the list of persons on our list, if any of you have other persons or concerns, joys or sorrows to add to our list this morning. Is that one? That's Keith and Kathy. Coming from Barbara, outside the wall, they have COVID and they're part sick. So we'll keep them in our prayers today. Barbara who? We just have Barbara today on the screen, so it's Barbara. That was who? Oh, happy birthday to you. We could sing. We often sing. Shall we? Let's sing. But we don't always do that. So we'll let people, if they dare, ask you after worship and fellowship hall. Other joys, concerns. Mm-hmm. Okay, Joey's co-worker and his son-in-law experienced a co-worker who suffered an injury in the workplace. It was Joey's first day of work, second day of work, and he administered the first aid. So, but keep Scott is his name, and keep Scott in my third. So that's Jane, who's in rehab, and concern for the care she's receiving in rehab. And so we keep her in our prayers. So an update on Beth Hatcher, who is at home and doing better. Sorry to hear that. Shirley's son Jeffrey, who's been diagnosed with Lyme disease. Sounds like he's been climbing in the Italian Alps. I saw that snow a little earlier in the season. So Lynn would have us speak her sons and if we're traveling, one in Alaska and one in Italy. Well, Anna's friend Susan is recovering from heart surgery. Reminder that the fires are burning and the smoke is blowing, and for many persons, it presents sounds and breathing. So for all of those affected by tornadoes, loss of power in your mother. Well, let's hold all of these concerns, joys, sorrows, challenges that have been mentioned, and I invite you to remain active with the spirit that you bring the fullness of your awareness to our time of prayer. We continue our worship now, and we're going to sing. And it's our devotional hymn, which is number 594. So I invite you to stand, and we'll sing the first three verses. Thank you.
Full of strength. Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks for life in your creation, and in particular life in our United States. And on this day, as we worship you, we pray to bring to bear our gratitude in service of our true citizenship. One in the United States, and one in the world to come. Jesus, kingdom of God, of yours. One in Christ we pray. Amen.
Nobody had any idea. They hate religion. They hate God. What they've done to religion is so horrible, horrible. This was former President Donald Trump and now presidential candidate Donald Trump at a Moms for Liberty event on Friday. It's not the first time he's delivered such kind of rhetoric. He was speaking the day of Democrats. And it's not the last time he's spoken with divisive rhetoric. And it's likely not the last time he'll speak in such a way. But it is the last time that I'll listen and keep silent in my life as a U.S. citizen and as a Christian charged with preaching in the church. Unless you become a little antsy in your seat now for the way I speak, rest assured, I won't be speaking about politics in terms of explicitly endorsing a candidate or candidates. Instead, I'll be wondering with you about the relationship between my Christian faith and my understanding as a citizen of the United States. And I certainly won't be preaching in a manner in which Global Vision Bible Church pastor Glenn spoke about last year at this time, and as quoted in Newsweek. And looking around, I think I'll change one word in the quote. He preached, "If you vote Democrat, I don't even want you around this church. You can get out. You can get out, you demon. You cannot be a Christian and vote Democrat in this nation. And I don't care how mad that makes you. You can get as peeved off as you want to. You cannot be a Christian and vote Democrat in this nation. You cannot be a Democrat and a Christian. You cannot." Somebody say, amen. The rest of you, get out. Get out. I'll leave it to you to guess which one word I changed. And I'll add, what might you do if I preached this way in your church? I would hope that if I preached this way in your church, you would call the question on my fitness with the local committee on church and ministry in which I held my standing. Call the question as to whether I'm qualified. Fit is the word we use in the United Church of Christ. Fit to preach in and on behalf of the United Church of Christ. And I would hope that the Committee on Church and Ministry would find that I was not. But that's the United Church of Christ.
and that preaching with an ordained minister's code. I had other plans for this sermon today. You know, as I alluded to, I was not here last weekend. Thank God. Thank you, search committee members. And so, not being here last weekend, I started working on a sermon for this 4th of July weekend 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago. And then, this week's event came into my life. And by Tuesday, I was starting to get a little reactivity within me. And by Friday, a little bit of responsibility within me. And so, after the manner, remembering the counsel of the giant 20th century theologian Karl Barth, I tossed. I printed out the sermon that was on its way, and I ripped it up, and I tossed it into the basket, and I prayed, "Help me, Lord." A few times this has happened in my life. Not too many, thank God. But sometimes the Holy Spirit calls something different forth from us. Now, I mentioned Karl Barth, giant 20th century theologian, wrote the last great systematic theology that took him 35 years, and he still wasn't finished. 9,000 plus pages. But he was a Swiss Reformed theologian and a pastor during the middle of the 20th century. And he was part of the German Confessing Church in the 1930s and 40s. The Confessing Church, which opposed the plan in Germany of the political leaders to unite all of the Christian churches there into one pro-Nazi German evangelical church. Some churches protested against this, and Karl Barth was part author of something called the Barman Confession of 1934, in which these churches produced a statement making a number of points, which included, perhaps the most important one of all, that the Lord Jesus was a Christian's Lord and a Lord before any leader, hero of any nation, if they had their nation in mind then. And so I thought, why don't I simply discard a lot of the material today and work, as Karl Barth said, as a preacher should work. What did he say? A preacher should preach with the Bible in one hand, and I'm holding it right side up, a Bible in one hand and a newspaper in the other. Scripture and current events. And we stand in the middle, trying to figure out how to be citizens in this world, as well as the world to come. I've had enough, I don't know about you, but I've had enough of former President Trump and any other political leaders who use rhetoric in divisive, hateful, and hurtful ways. I learned as a kid to say to bullies, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me." But you know what? Secretly, sometimes names did hurt. And sometimes divisive, hateful, hurtful language leads to divisiveness of groups of people, hatred of others, and hurtful kinds of behavior. Words do have power. Wasn't it someone said the pen could be mightier than the sword? Well, maybe so, but sometimes it leads to people picking up swords. And I wonder if this such kind of rhetoric might in the end
so divide our nation? It's a question I asked Marcia after she gave us the number of 347 years old. What might be our condition then? So it is, as we come to this table, which to me represents unifying values, unity amidst diversity of understanding, what we might come to. And so let's sermonize together for a moment with the Bible in one of our hands and current events in the other. And I added a scripture that's not in your program today. From Exodus, chapter 20. It's the first three of the Ten Commandments. Then God spoke all of these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. Not the land of Egypt in any other way than a geographical kind of designation, but out of the house of slavery, out of the kind of rulership that oppressed others until they were not perceived as human. That is God's fundamental identity. And that is why the commandments are worth listening to. And the first, you shall have no other God before me. Oh, it's okay if you have other gods. We don't have to jump to absolute monotheism here to be followers. But we have one God before others. And if we want to broaden the definition to God to include things like, oh, some people have said money is like a God. Some people have said power holding can be like a God. Whatever. Thou shalt have no other gods before our God, the God who redeems, the God who loves so much. This God brings people out of slavery. And you shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. Our God cannot be contained in anything we might idolize. Our God is always the God that transcends all kinds of things. Our God is a living God. A living God who delivers people from their slavery, because God loves all people. And third, you shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God. You might have heard it in that loose language, take the Lord's name in vain, but it's stronger than that in the Hebrew. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God. And there's even a stronger translation that would read, you shall not abuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. What that means to me is God transcends all of our temptations to say, God told me to say this. God told me to do this. God is in me, and what I say to you comes directly from God. I don't know whether I'm right or wrong, whether I'm onto something or not when I stand and preach. You have to decide that for yourself. Am I conveying to you what makes sense or not? And what I ask you today is to ask,
is what I make sense in the name of our God, the God we put before all other gods, not the vengeful God, but the God of love who redeemed and delivered, who brought his people out of slavery, and therefore is worth paying attention to. Well, Jesus is confronted by this. They, in this case, it was his own brothers in the faith, Pharisees maybe even, because Jesus may have been a Pharisee with a disagreement with orthodoxy within the Pharisaic community of his time. They wanted to trap him, it is said. And so they asked him, some of his brothers asked him a question. And we're going to hear that in the Gospel of Mark now.
Reading from the 12th chapter of Mark, verses 13 through 17. Then they sent him some Pharisees and some Herodians to trap him in what he said. And they came and said to him, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality, but teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? Should we pay them or should we not?" But knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them,
"Why are you putting me to the test? Bring me a denarius, a coin, and let me see it."
And they brought one to him. Then Jesus said to them,
"Whose head is this? And whose title on this coin?"
They answered, "The emperor." And Jesus said to them,
"Well then, you give to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and I'll give to God the things that are God's." From this, we understand that we do have a conundrum, sometimes, being those with dual citizenship status in the world of today and status in the world to come. The question is, how much are we going to put into each? And when there's a crunch, which will receive our loyalty? I had a New Testament professor who said there's some humor here in this little encounter. And the humor comes from those Pharisees who were testing Jesus, their opponent, because they, by carrying that coin in their pocket, were carrying a graven image. Or if you remember, there was a cult of Caesar, and Caesar, born of another virgin, was God-like, if not God, in the minds of many. In any case, when we jump to Paul, in his letter to the Galatians, a letter that's called the love letter by scholars because Paul uses the word so often, and it's clear that Galatia, of all the churches that Paul wrote to, was a church he'd want to be a member of, because it was a unified church of love and not a conflicted church filled with hate and they and they. And so, Paul writes, "Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the law is summed up in a single commandment, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. So what might we say as Christians and concerned Americans as we come to another 4th of July? What birthday gift might we give to our nation? Certainly, neither our silence nor Christian nationalism. But how about the gospel of Jesus and our practice of it? The practice in which we serve a God who loves all persons with our beliefs and our actions, and that we support a politics that unifies rather than divides. It focuses on debating on the ways and means of achieving our goals as a nation rather than demonizing. One that employs love of others as well as oneself. One that emphasizes personal freedom and relational responsibility, not only because God loves all persons, but because our forebears gave us a vision, that a proposition, remember, that all are created equal, and not only that, a pledge that we make, a pledge not just to liberty, but liberty and justice for all. That's me. You be the judge. You have a vote too. Amen. God, on this day when we gather and worship you as Christians united from different denominations, we invite you to look upon us, and we pray that you see joy in our coming together, in our unity amidst our differences. And we pray today, as our nation comes to another birthday, that we might give a gift that is faithful to our understanding of what you value, what you call your stewardship to be. We pray, O gracious God, that we are following faithfully after the manner of Jesus, our teacher and savior. Today, as we pray, we bring together our prayers from our lives, our unique lives, as well as the lives of our congregation. And so we pray. We pray for Susan. Pray that her heart is on the mend.
We pray for Jeffrey living with Lyme disease. And we pray for Joey, Cindy. We pray for Keith and Kathy with COVID. And we pray for Jane and rehab. And as we name each of these persons, O gracious God, to you, we remember those who are nameless to us, suffering in so many kinds of ways. And we pray that you bring to bear out of your love's concern for deliverance the kinds of resources and gifts that each needs. And we pray for groups of people, groups of diversity within our nation, groups of diversity around this world. And we pray where there is divisiveness, it will not descend into demonizing and hatred and to unnecessary death. Bless us, O gracious God, with the gifts we need to continue to trust in you, to trust in the way of Jesus, and to practice courageous love until your envisioned realm of well-being for all, shalom, comes. And until then, keep us and hold us as your people gathered together, worshiping, learning, and serving. And especially today, we look forward to the time and chapter to come here at UCC Burlington with the pastoral leadership of Andrew. One in Christ, we joyfully pray. Amen.
Amen. The earth belongs to God and everything that's in it, the world and everyone who lives in it. Freely we have received, so freely let us give, that the ministry of Jesus Christ may flourish in this community and beyond.
Thank you.
receive now these our gifts as signs of opening ourselves in mind and heart to serving your redeeming love. In Christ we pray. Amen. I'd like you to be seated. This is not our table. This is God's table. As such, all of us are welcome to sit here, to speak, and to listen. Listen to Christ, to tell Christ of our concerns, our need for healing, our need for guidance on living. You, because you are created and loved by God, are welcome at Christ's table. So I hope you will come.
Join in this responsive invitation. Come to this table at which Jesus celebrated God's deliverance of his people from slavery and injustice and entrusted his eternal well-being to God's promise of everlasting love.
We gather around this table seeking to satisfy our yearning, personal and global, for heavenly well-being for all.
Come as you are, with these hopes that you might be nourished by Christ Jesus for living freely the life of discipleship to which you are called.
Hopeful of our salvation and moved to follow Jesus' way, life, and truth, we open ourselves to these elements representing Christ's Holy Spirit of love. Let us sing now our communion hymn, verses 1 and 2, as we gather at your table, number 332. O God, most holy, we give you thanks for your creating and saving act across all time, for sending us out into the wider world to learn and gain experience when clearly we were not yet ready for heaven, for giving us leaders and teachers to
be taught and lived out your commandment, your love of all people, your justice, your peace, your shalom, and for your sending of prophets when our leaders failed us, and your people, and for, in the end, giving us the gift of Christ Jesus, who taught so clearly and loved so completely that, ironically, he was a threat to those at the top of the status quo, that he gave his life, that he brought the courage of his love to bear, that we might know your love's dependability for all time, through all time, until we are ready. And now, as we share these elements, let them become for us living memory of all of your grace. And not only that, living memory that moves us to move in Christ-like ways in our lives and lives. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Remember how Jesus shared a liberating meal, a meal celebrating God's love and redemptive desire, and how at the end of that meal he broke some of the leftover bread, and upon blessing it and giving thanks, he said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you." Jesus said, "As often as you eat of this bread, do so in remembrance of me." So ministering to you now in his name, I invite you to take and eat, symbol of your personal relationship by God's love. Remember how at that same meal, Jesus took one of the leftover cups, the cup of reconciliation, and upon blessing it and giving thanks, Jesus said, "Take and drink. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and all for the forgiveness of sin." Jesus said, "As often as you drink of this cup, do so in remembrance of me." It's now ministering to you in his name. I invite you to hold the cup for a moment that we might partake of it together, symbol of our unity and equality with Christ's love, God's love. Pray. Dear God, thank you. Thank you amidst the divisiveness of this world. You have given us this space, this table of Christ, in which we may come safely to be together and to share in Christ's name and spirit. Thank you. Thank you. Amen.
Let us join responsibly in these words of commissioning. Fellow citizens of God's heavenly realm and earth, let us walk faithfully, praying and professing our faith before God.
Holy God of love, as citizens of your creation and stewards of your vision, we remember and pray to follow Jesus after the manner of our ancestors' witness, of which we now speak together.
We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, goodness, and love, and in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord and Savior, who for us and for our salvation lived and died and rose again and liveth evermore, and in the Holy Spirit, who taketh of the things of Christ and revealeth them to us, renewing, comforting, and inspiring our souls. We walk united in striving to know the will of God as taught in Holy Scripture, and in our purpose to walk in the ways of the Lord, made known or to be made known to us. We hold it to be the mission of the Church of Christ to proclaim the gospel to all, exalting the worship of the one true God, and laboring for the progress of knowledge, the promotion of justice, the reign of peace, and the realization of liberty and justice for all, depending, as did our ancestors, upon the continued guidance of the Holy Spirit to lead us into all truth. We shall work and pray for the transformation of the world into the kingdom of God, and we look with faith for the triumph of righteousness and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us join together now in singing through the story to tell to the nation on your insert.
Thank you.
remembering God our Creator in the way of Jesus, our teacher and Savior. Go by the power of the Holy Spirit to listen compassionately and speak with love to all who are in your life today and to come. And be the church together, supporting one another in this mission in the wider world. Go in peace. Amen.